All right. Sunil.
For today, we will be going through communicating bad news, how to manage pollution, and how to manage anger. So you have had basics of communication session previously. So this is a very common situation which we usually face with pollution or communicating bad news. So we will hear how to do that, how to manage this from Dr. Biju. And as I told you earlier, he is the consultant and head of quality medicine department at Rajagiri Hospital, Alwar. So we will have Dr. Biju's presentation followed by a discussion, and then patient story followed by discussion. So it's over to you, Biju.
Thank you, Sunil. And thank you, Rajlakshmi and Pallium India for hosting this. It's always great to be part of the ECHO program that Pallium India runs. I hope my voice is clear.
Yes, sir, it is.
Okay. So welcome to all the participants. This is the second time we are meeting. As Sunil said, last time we covered the general aspects of communication. This time we are going to talk about these three aspects. Now, for you to understand, in simple words, these three things, communicating bad news, managing pollution, and dealing with an angry person, you have to approach it like a surgical procedure. That is the best way to see these things. These are communication procedures, and like any other surgical procedure, there is an indication, there is a standard operating procedure, and an expected outcome. So that is the same thing for communication procedures. In the last session, we learned general things, and now we are going to learn some communication procedure. Next slide, please. So when we talk about communicating bad news, usually what we hear is that some doctors say, I never tell it to my patients. And some doctors say, I always tell it to my patients. So some doctors who always tell their patients, I'm saying this patient specifically because we all talk to the family members. I'm talking specifically about the patient doctor communication, communicating of bad news to the patient. So there are some doctors who practice full disclosure model, and they say every patient has the right to know, and I honor that right. And that's why I tell the bad news to every patient. There are some doctors who would say, no, I do not want them to feel the botheration of knowing such a bad news. I do not tell it to them. I tell to the family members. I never tell it to the patient. Why bother? Why make that person upset? So some people practice non-disclosure model. Next slide, please. So the problem with either of the model is we have to take into consideration the patient's rights. And when it comes to bad news, what is the patient right? The patient has the right to know the bad news. And at the same time, patient also has the right not to know the bad news. What that means is there are some people who want to know, and then there are some people who do not want to know. So those who do not want to know, if you impose a bad news on them, it will be such a torture. And for those who want to know, if you do not disclose it to them, that also becomes a big torture. So the problem with this procedure is we as doctors should not be the one deciding whether somebody should know or not. It has to be decided by the person. For example, if I am the patient, I have to decide whether I want to know or not. And it is the job of the doctor concerned to figure out whether I want to know or not. So as a doctor, we have to figure out whether the patient sitting in front of us wants to know which category the patient falls in, whether the patient wants to know or the patient doesn't want to know. And those who want to know, we have to figure out how much they want to know, whether they want to know 100%, whether they want to know 50%, whether they want to know 78.9%. So it is for us to figure out the person sitting in front of us, the patient sitting in front of us, falls primarily under which category, wants to know, doesn't want to know. And if they want to know, then how much they want to know. And that is exactly where the skill of communicating bad news is there. Because you give information only to those who are ready to receive that information and only in quantity enough for their satisfaction, not less, not more. And those who do not want to know, we will not impose that information. Next slide. Next slide. So this model where we do not impose, we try to figure out whether they want to know or not. And if they want to know, how much they want to know, is called an individualized disclosure model. This is different from a full disclosure model and a non-disclosure model that we talked about two slides ago. So this is a model which we tailor make for every individual. Right now, it may seem like a big difficult problem, but once you learn the skill, like any skill, it becomes easy to do it. Next slide. So before we get on to how to communicate bad news, we have to now figure out who should communicate bad news. So the person who is communicating bad news need not necessarily always be a doctor. It can be the patient's best friend, or it can be the patient's family member or a relative, or it can be a doctor or a nurse or a counselor, anybody. However, whoever is communicating the bad news must have the trust of the patient, should have adequate information. And I may remind the doctors in this group, the information should be without medical jargon. It should be in simple language that people can understand. They don't need to know what is the TNM status. They just need to know whether it is cancer and whether it is curable or incurable or in the end stage. And whatever stage it is, what can be done and what cannot be done. In simple words, that is where the skill lies, in giving the information in an honest and simple language. And of course, the skill to communicate. The skill is, first of all, figuring out whether the person wants to know or not, and then figuring out if the person wants to know, to figure out whether how much the patient wants to know. And then the skill is how to deliver it. All these are skills. Next slide. So again, before going on to how, let's understand why. There are many medical professionals and there are many common lay people who are of the opinion that it is better not to subject the patient to bad news, because why unnecessarily? What's the purpose? What's the use? Let the person live peacefully for some days. Remember, if the person wants to know and is not being told, the person is never going to be peaceful. And if the person doesn't want to know and you impose information, then definitely that person is not going to be peaceful. So we have to differentiate and then communicate. And for those who want to know, what are the benefits for them? For example, if there is a will to be written, or if the person wants to meet somebody who have been out of touch for a long time, or if the person had a dispute, a personal dispute with somebody and would like to forgive and forget and convey it. And if there are some other matters related to finances that the person wants to inform the family, and or if the person wants to undergo any of the desires that the person had been keeping away for a long time. All of these things can be done while the person has still some physical and mental capabilities left. So the earlier the person understands, the more the person can close their life's business. So that is one big opportunity that the person can get only
if the person is told what is the real status of their medical condition. If the person has an end-stage medical condition, end-stage motor neuron disease, end-stage COPD, end-stage malignancy, end-stage cardiac failure, whatever it is, only when people know that their time is limited, that they will think in terms of what all they need to do. And of course, in between hearing the news and coming to this conclusion that what they have to do, they will undergo sometimes a lot of emotional distress. They have to come into terms with the fact that will take some time. But ultimately, people will reach this point where they come to terms with what they have and then think, what can I do with the time I have? Now, this can happen only if they know. And the earlier we tell them, the better it is, because they will have a longer physical and mental capability time before they become totally bedridden or totally lose the capacity to think. Another problem is hospital hopping and doctor shopping. At one place, the family is told, the patient is not told, the family is told nothing to be done, but the patient does not know. And after some time, when the person does not get the benefit that the person was hoping for, because the patient's expectation is way above the reality. The family understands, everybody understands, but the patient does not understand. And it is not the patient's fault. The patient's expectation is way above reality, and we can do only what is real, really possible. And that will lead to patient's dissatisfaction. And if the patient says, take me to another hospital, the family cannot say, no, you stay there. You are fine here. So when the patient says, take me some other place, the family is forced to take the person to another place. And the patient goes to a new place and the hopes rises once again. And in the new place also, after some time, the patient feels disappointed. And then maybe some family member will say, or some relative will say, go to that place, there is a good treatment available. Or then all kinds of other treatments, etc. will be tried. So there will be hopping from place to place and shopping for doctor to doctor. And all of these things, they are wasting their time, energy, effort, and money. Many a times, a lot of people are pushed into poverty because of serious illness where they have not been told the futility of the condition, and they persist in focusing on futile medical intervention. And as a result, the house is sold, the cow is sold, the jewelry is sold, everything is sold, they take on debt. And as a result, the whole family is ruined. A generation is pushed into poverty because now they can't afford the school fee of the children. They have to go for manual labor, etc., etc. So a lot of this problem lies with the medical related issue, where people become bankrupt by focusing on futile medical intervention. And why this happened? Because we did not take enough effort to counsel the patient and the family. And another problem is the barrier between the patient and the family. Sometimes the family knows and the patient is not told. Sometimes the patient knows, the family is not told. Or sometimes the patient and family know, but they try to hide it from each other. And as a result, what happens? Inside the house, there is a drama being played where the patient behaves as if it's okay, or the patient does not know what is going on. The family behaves that everything is okay. And after some time, when the family cannot take this anymore, they come to the doctor's home, doctor's office and cry. The family goes to the neighbor's house and cry. Or if there's a rich family, they have many rooms, they go to the father's room, lock the bathroom and cry. And ultimately, the precious time is lost in playing a drama inside the house. Instead of that, there's the precious time to hug and cry. There's a precious time to say how much I care for you. There's a precious time to say, I love you. All of these things are lost because everybody puts on a mask and plays a drama. And as palliative care professionals, you are learning how to provide total care, physical, emotional, psychosocial, everything. But if the person has not been told and the family is trying to collude with you, don't tell it to the patient, then how are you ever going to provide total care? You can at best try to provide some physical care. But you know that a lot of physical symptoms will be raised if there's a lot of emotional symptoms. So until and unless you focus on total care, you cannot provide good palliation for a person, especially in the terminal stages of their life. So these are the reasons why communicating bad news is very, very important. Next slide, please. Rajlakshmi, can you mute everybody, please? We're having a lot of background voice, noise distraction.
Yes, sir, I am muted. I request all participants to stay muted.
Thank you. Now, talking about communicating bad news, there is a simple SPIKES protocol for all of you to remember. SPIKES. S stands for setting up the interview. You have to have a proper place and a time where you can do this interview without disturbance. In my practice, whenever I have to have a communication procedure, which is a dedicated time for that, I make sure I do it in the evening. Because in the evening time, the OP area is much less crowded. There is much less noise. And I would have finished all my other work in IP, OP, etc. So I have some time which I can focus on serious communication procedures. So it is up to you how you want to arrange it, but you have to dedicate a place and a time for that. Just think of how a surgeon would do a surgery. The person will give an appointment for an elective surgery, right? So communicating bad news is an elective procedure. Then we have to find out what does the person know about his or her problem. So that is the perception. We have to ask, this can happen in the first interview itself. Or you can, try to assess over a period of time. Then we have to obtain the patient's invitation. So would you want to know more about your disease? So the patient will then feel that they have been invited for a conversation. So they can say, yes, I want to know. And then you have to proceed. Now in this part, before you proceed, you have to give a warning shot. I'll come to the warning shot later on. And then an honest sharing of knowledge. And as a result, there will be an outburst of emotion. And once the emotion subside, you plan and then you summarize and then you close the interview. Remember, during last session, we talked about history taking 2.0. So just remember that. Next slide. So the procedure of communicating bad news. Next slide. This is now we are going to learn how to do it. So we have to do a bit of pre-procedure preparation, up to date yourself on the patient's medical condition. You may be seeing the patient every day, doesn't matter. Go back on the old records, go back on the records that has been maintained during the IP. Check on everything because it is good to be prepared. And then allot a dedicated time slot for the procedure. As I said, most of the time when it is a matter of serious communication procedures, I prefer to do it late in the evening when my OP area is quiet, so I can do it in my OP. I would never do a serious communication procedure on the veranda or in the ward. There has to be a proper place and time for it. It is a elective procedure. And to set the environment, all the active listening skills we learned last time, we put it into practice. Remember the previous that history taking 2.0, just remember that. Next slide. So how do we start the interview? If you are seeing the patient for the first time, you take the patient history. That is the we are all doing all the other things that we learned in history 2.0, greeting, welcoming them to sit down, etc., etc. So that I am not going into again. I am assuming you already familiar with that. So you take a patient's history and get the patient's insight and concern while you're taking the history. For example, the patient says, I was asked to take an x-ray. So you can say, okay, why did the doctor ask you to take an x-ray? And what was the result of the x-ray? What did the doctor tell you? So the patient may say, then the doctor asked me to take an x-ray. That's why I took an x-ray. Or the patient says that the result, they said something about something like a shadow. And then they asked me to go to the city hospital. So every time they tell you a part of the history, you have to dig deeper and find out what is their insight. What do they understand? Why this test was ordered? What was the result of that test? Why this doctor advised you to go to this place? What was the idea behind it? So all of this you have to ask.
The patient may have the right information, or the patient may have the wrong information, or the patient may have no information. All of that is part of insight. And once you have all the data that you want from the patient, then you ask if the patient wants to know something about his or her problem. This is the invitation you are extending to the patient. Sometimes you don't have to extend an invitation. The patient may himself or herself ask, "Doctor, what is wrong with me? Why am I like this?" So if they don't ask, you can extend that invitation. Do you want to know what is wrong with you? And if they say yes, don't straight away start telling them the problem. Always give a warning shot. The warning shot is what differentiates a person who wants to know and from a person who does not want to know. Next slide. So this is an example of a warning shot. If it is something serious, would you still want to know? If it is something serious, would you still want to know? This is a warning shot. Because the moment a person hears this, till this time, it was like any other interview. It was not a very serious interview. But the moment you give a warning shot, suddenly the mood in the room will change from a casual interview to a serious interview. And this is the time, perhaps for the first time, the patient may realize that there is something serious with me. And if the person falls into the category of somebody who doesn't want to know, then may not make eye contact, may look up or look down, but not make eye contact. Or may make some excuses, saying that I'm a little busy, I have to go. Can you give me some of my medicines? I'll come back after 1 week or 2 weeks. Or the patient may say straight away, "No, I don't want to know. Tell it to my children, or tell it to my husband, tell it to my brother, tell it to my sister, tell it to my parents," whatever. So either of these scenarios, then you have to understand this person is not presently mentally willing to listen to a bad news. The person may come back after 1 week and say, "I want to know about it." But presently the person is not willing. And then do not proceed with communicating bad news. However, if the person wants to know, the person will look into your eyes and say yes. Then there is no confusion. The person looks into your eyes and says yes. That means this person wants to know and is willing to bear it. Until and unless there is a very clear indication after a warning shot that the person wants to know, when the person looks into your eyes and says, "I want to know," after you give a warning shot, then there is no confusion, you can proceed. Otherwise, do not proceed. And if people can write in the chat box your local version of this warning shot. This is in English. If it is something serious, would you still want to know? In Hindi, maybe I'll say, "Agar baat kuch serious hai, to kya aap phir bhi janna chahenge?" So that would be one warning shot in Hindi. In Malayalam, I would say, "Karyam serious aanengilum arayanam nindo." So it is important that you get the wordings right, because warning shot has to be precise. You cannot beat around the bush. The message has to be very, very clear. Do not say your reports are come and all these things are there. No, don't put unnecessary information there. Keep it short, simple, and clear. If it is something serious, would you still want to know? Agar baat serious hai, to kya aap phir bhi janna chahenge? Karyam itre serious aanengilum arayanum nindo. So I don't know any other language. So but feel free to send in your comments on that, how you would frame it, because you have to think of how you are going to frame in your regional language, because this warning shot is the most important part of communicating bad news. This is the point where the whole nature, the whole feel of the interview is going to change. Next slide. After the warning shot, as I said, the atmosphere becomes more serious. The patient gets a chance to reconsider the decision, whether wants to know or not. And if the patient confirms a desire to know, then you have to adopt a narrative approach. A narrative approach means a storytelling approach. You tell the story of the patient to the patient from the beginning. You already know the story because the patient told you, but now you are going to tell the story of the patient to the patient from the beginning. Next slide. So this is what I was talking about. So I'm just giving some example. So you now know the patient's history. You now know the patient's insight. In the insight, you know where are the blank spots where the patient does not know what is going on. What are the blank spots? So when you tell the story of the patient to the patient from the beginning, you fill in the blanks by small chunks of information as you go along the story, as you progress along the story. For example, the story is very briefly, a patient has come to you with hoarseness of voice and weight loss of 1 month duration. The patient initially went to a local doctor, and the local doctor gave some medicines for 1 week. There was no relief, so he went back to the local doctor. Local doctor asked the patient to get an X-ray done. And so I asked the patient, so why did the doctor ask for an X-ray? The patient said, I don't know. The doctor asked for an X-ray, so I got an X-ray done. Okay, then what happened? So then the doctor looked at the X-ray and said, there is something like a shadow. So he asked me, the patient said that the doctor looked at the X-ray and then gave me a reference letter to the city hospital. So I asked the patient, so what did the X-ray show? The doctor did not tell me that. He said, just take this reference letter and go to the city hospital. And in the city hospital, what happened? Well, they wanted me to get a scan done. And did they tell you why the scan was done? No, they did not tell me. They said that the scan has to be done. And then what was the scan result? They said something, but it was very technical. I did not understand anything. And then they got an injection test done from my neck. There was a small swelling in the neck, and they put in a needle there, and they tested for that. So what was that about? I don't know. They said this to find out what exactly is going on. And then what happened? Then they gave me a reference letter to come here. That further treatment will be here. So if that is the story, we are at this place where I'm giving the chunk of information regarding the X-ray. So I tell them that the X-ray showed something like a shadow. And so I'm telling the story of the patient to the patient that 1 month ago, you had cough and weight loss. You went to the local doctor, and the local doctor initially gave you some antibiotics and vitamins for 1 week. And with that, since there was no much relief, that is why the doctor asked you to get an X-ray done. And in the X-ray, it showed something like a shadow. So something like a shadow is what the initial chunk of information I am providing. And when you provide a new information, focus on the patient's body language, especially focus on their eye contact. If they are maintaining eye contact, that means they want more. So you provide more information. Next slide. So the X-ray showed something like a shadow, and then the shadow turned out to be something like a tumor. So this is how you gradually grade up the information. So I'm telling the story of the patient to the patient. I'm saying that the X-ray showed something like a shadow, and to understand what the shadow was, you were referred to the city hospital. And to find out what the shadow was, they wanted to do a scan. So you may have noticed that I initially said something like a shadow, and something like a shadow becomes a shadow. The X-ray showed something like a shadow, and please notice, and to find out what the shadow was, they sent you to the city hospital. So something like a shadow becomes a shadow. And to find out what the shadow was, they did a scan. And in the scan, they found something like a tumor. So from something like a shadow, there is a progression to shadow. And from a shadow, there is a progression to something like a tumor. And to find out whether this tumor was something like a cancer, they tested from the node in your neck. And every time a chunk of information, like something like a shadow, shadow, something like a tumor, something like a cancer. Every time when you are proceeding with the story, you are filling in the blanks with escalation of information. Keep a lookout on the patient's eye contact. If at any point of time the patient breaks eye contact, is not looking at you, then stop the story there. It is possible that the patient may start looking back at you, only then restart the story. Because when the patient makes eye contact, the patient is giving you permission to continue with the story. If the patient does not make eye contact, then that means the patient is digesting the new information inside and needs some time. So pauses are very important when you are doing this procedure. For example, even a surgery is being done and an artery is cut, you put a pressure over that and you wait so that the bleeding stops. That same waiting is the pause in this procedure called communicating bad news. So procedures here in surgery, waiting for the bleeding to stop is important. Here the pause for the person to digest the new information is important. Never rush with information. Do it at the patient's pace. And once the patient has started looking at you, then you can proceed. However, if the patient is not looking at you and you are confused, you don't know whether the patient wants to know more or, you know, should I stop it here? You can always ask the person, should I proceed or shall we stop here? It is very simple. It's very important to be very simple and honest in this procedure. Ask, should I stop here or should I proceed with more information? And if the patient had enough, the person may not make eye contact. That means the patient had enough for the time being, does not want more. If that is the position, do not proceed with further information. Wherever you are, stop it there. And you can talk about other things, about what medicines to be taken, etc., etc., but do not proceed. However, if the person after some time again makes eye contact, then you can proceed. And if you're still having doubt, you can always ask, should I proceed with what we are discussing? And if the patient seems reluctant, then you can say, maybe if you want, we can talk about it next time. If the patient readily agrees, that means the patient is kind of relieved that he does not want to hear, he does not have to hear it for presently. Otherwise, the patient says, no, I want to hear it. Then you are sure that the person still has capacity to hear more of this bad news, so you can proceed with it. So something like a shadow becomes a shadow. The shadow becomes something like a tumor, and something like a tumor becomes a tumor, and tumor becomes something like a cancer, and something like a cancer becomes a cancer. Next slide. So you have to finish the story by either the patient getting the full information or enough information for the time being. It is not our agenda to give the full information. Our expertise is facilitating information as much as the patient wants. So if the patient wants 100% information, we provide that. If the patient wants less than that, wherever the patient wants, we will take it from till there and not more than that. And once the person has listened to the bad news, be prepared for an emotional reaction. The emotional reaction can be in the form of tears, it can be in the form of anger, it can be in the form of a stunned silence, or surprisingly, sometimes a person can be very equanimous and says, I knew it. I knew they were not telling me. I always suspected this. Now I'm relieved to hear it. It can happen even that way. So be prepared for any kind of reaction. But important thing is, allow the reaction to happen. Once you have told them whatever they wanted to know, expect an emotional reaction and allow the emotional reaction to run its course. Because when they start crying or start getting angry or agitated, that time trying to say, no, don't worry, we are here, none of that is going to work. The only thing that is going to work is you taking a big pause and allowing them to ventilate their emotion. Because when the emotional part of the brain is on a high, the logical part of the brain will not work. So allow the emotion to ventilate. Next slide. So the most important thing that I can tell you after the warning shot is, once you have given the information, be with the patient. Don't do something. Don't say something. Don't do anything. Just be there. Just your presence is very important. Don't do something. Don't say something. Just be there. Allow the person to ventilate. Next slide. And once the emotional reaction has subsided, ask for any further information that they would like to know. That, okay, this is the situation. Is there something else that you want to know about it? And once the patient has had an opportunity to ventilate emotion, then you can expect the patient to ask questions. Sometimes we may know the answers to the questions, and many times we may not know answers to the questions. And for the questions that we don't know the answer, we can always say, I'm sorry, I don't know. I can send you to somebody who knows, or I can ask somebody who may know an answer to that. Many times the questions that they ask may not be actual questions. For example, they say, what am I going to do about my children? How long am I going to live? So these kind of questions may be an actual question, or they may be just another form of ventilation of the emotion. If you're not very sure, it is always good to ask them, why did you say that? And then they will tell you why they said that. And many times they may not be asking a question. But if it is a question, if they specifically wanted to know, they'll say, I just wanted to know, I want to plan about my life and all. So in that situation, you may give an answer that you best can give. And many a times, remember, it is okay not to have an answer. It is very important to be there to sit and listen. Because that listening, as we said last time, is a very healing process. Be honest, clear, and precise in your answers. Or if you don't know the answer, tell that, I don't know, maybe I'll talk to somebody. Because there is always somebody who is more of an expert in these matters than you. There's always somebody who knows more about a certain issue. Or it's always good to ask our colleagues. And if somebody is terminally ill and says, I want to know, and because I want to plan. So one simple thing in palliative care that at least I usually say is, if somebody is becoming weaker by the month, the person has months to live. If somebody is becoming weaker by the week, the person would have weeks to live. And if somebody is becoming weaker by the day, probably the person has days to live. And the best person to judge that, instead of me as a doctor who sees once in a while for 10-15 minutes, the best person to judge that would be either the patient or the family themselves. Next slide, please. Do not give false hopes. Whatever you do, do not give false hope. Always give hope that is achievable. For example, we can always say, I'm sorry, the disease is spreading, but I'll make sure that you do not suffer. I'll make sure that you're not in pain, you are not suffering for what, however long you live. And many times, this kind of assurance, which is achievable, when you learn palliative medicine, all of these things are achievable. We can take care of suffering irrespective of the stage of disease up to the last breath of the person. Those are achievable things. And when we tell these things to the patient and family, they say this. That's all that I wanted to hear, that you will take care of me. You will not abandon me. So once all this discussion is done, give a clear plan of action, how we are going to do. And as we have discussed during last time, do it with the participatory decision-making by consensus. Let all people, let the patient, family, everybody put in their point of view, and then decide on the most practical way of management, not necessarily the best prescription. Next slide, please. So before you close the interview, ask for any other doubts or any other thing that they want to ask or say, and then close the interview by leaving the door open. Leaving the door open means you are always giving them some kind of a contact number through which they can be contacted. Through which you can be contacted. You don't want to give your personal number, don't give that, but give them something, some way of letting them know that the door is not shut behind them. Next slide, please. Post-procedure follow-up. So if the person is the communicating bad news was done in the OP or the patient was still in the IP, you can either visit them or call the patient before the day is over. And just ask, I just called to find out how you are doing. We had a very difficult discussion, very, you know, uncomfortable discussion today. So I just wondering how you are doing. And that's why I just called. I hope you're fine. And that gives them an opportunity to, you know that you care about them. And if you are busy, you can always designate this work to somebody in your team, either a colleague or a junior or somebody else within the team, who you can designate this job, that the person who had to face that bad news is not left unattended thereafter. And this also post-procedure call or a visit also gives them an opportunity for any further clarification or more information, because many a times when they hear a bad news, the whole brain just freezes up. No thoughts comes, no questions comes. So after some time, when they go back home or they go back to their ward or room in the hospital, sometimes after a couple of hours, maybe they are able to start thinking again. So it's always good to pay them a visit or give them a call. Next slide, please. Okay, go back. Yeah, so this is where the communicating bad news topic ends. If anybody has any questions regarding this, we can take it now. Or maybe, I don't know whether Sunil, you want me to proceed with collusion? Or
Please proceed with collusion and we will take the questions at the end.
Right. And if you have any questions in your mind right now, feel free to, Neelama says, how long should the interview last? There is no fixed time. It's like a question, how long should a cholecystectomy last? I think it will depend on surgeon to surgeon, depending on the skill. And the more skillful you are, then I guess your time will come down. But even for the most skillful surgeon, sometimes there might be complication and a cholecystectomy may take longer than average time for that particular surgeon. So there is no fixed time, because we are not fixing the time of the interview. It has to be done at the pace of the patient. The patient decides the pace of the interview. We do not rush in. I hope that answers that. So if you have more questions, send it in the chat box and Sunil and Rajlakshmi will look into it and pass it on to me later. So we'll go on to collusion. Collusion is essentially a conspiracy of silence, where the family comes and tells us, doctor, please don't tell it to the patient. Please don't tell it to him or her. And we are all familiar with this situation. We find ourselves in it all the time. So let's talk about collusion. Next slide. So why this happens? Because family is trying to protect their loved one. And they're trying to protect their loved one from us. And why they want to protect them, their loved one, that is the patient, from us, because they know that we know. We have the information. And they are scared. They are scared we may tell it to the patient. That's why before they bring the patient to us, they come to us before they bring the patient to us, and then they come to us and say, please do not tell it to the patient. So they are trying to get into a deal, get into an agreement, get into a conspiracy of silence with us, so that we will not tell it to the patient. Next slide. So first and foremost, understand that now when it comes to collusion, you as the medical care provider, you have to forget about the patient. Because right now, you have a family which is in absolute terror, absolute fear. They are so scared that we may harm their loved one. So first and foremost, it is important to acknowledge that the family is afraid of us. Next slide. And it is important that we do not challenge their beliefs. From our point of view, with our scientific background, education, training, we know that what they're saying is absolutely, you know, it is nonsense. But they believe so. And whatever people believe, if we challenge them, then they become more agitated, they become more anxious, they become more fearful.
So do not challenge, do not say, no, 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 nothing will happen. We'll tell the patient, no, no, don't worry anything. So do not do that. Accept that patient, the family is anxious. Accept that the family is afraid of us. Do not challenge their belief system. Do not challenge the fact that they believe that we may harm the patient by telling the patient the bad news. They believe that the patient will be harmed. We believe it will not be. But right now, their belief is important. Next slide. Agree to collude. Just say, okay, if you don't want me to tell your patient, okay, fine, no problem. I even asked them, so what have you told him about the disease? So they may say, oh, we have told him this, just a small ulcer in the stomach, and it will take 2 weeks, 2 months with medicines to completely heal. So I tell them, is it okay if I also say the same thing? So basically what I'm trying to do is calm the family down. Because if you have a very anxious family, they are going to constantly interfere in my relationship with my patient. I am never going to have a peaceful time with the patient. So first of all, I need to have the family on my side. And to have the trust of the family, I agree to collude with them. And I'm not going to play any tricks. I cannot reach the patient without the family on my side. So I see the patient, I examine the patient, I take history taking without ever actually going into the communicating bad news to the patient. And then I would prescribe medications and get the patient comfortable. So within this one meeting or two meetings, the family will start trusting me. That is the most important part. If I have to help the patient and the family, I have to have their trust. So I cannot go on a collusion path with them. If I have to take care of collusion, I have to avoid collision. I hope you understand the play of word. If I have to take care of collusion, I cannot do it with the family and me disagreeing on it. We have to have a good relationship, a trusting relationship. Next slide. And as we go along, once the good relationship is taken care of, that happens by listening more to them, listening to their beliefs, not challenging them, and also providing good comfort care to the patient. And once the relationship is maintained, at that point of time, next slide, I would slowly bring in these topics, which I talked to you just a little while ago, while we were talking about communicating bad news, why it is important to communicate bad news. So these topics should come, but not in the beginning, at a later date. When by a couple of meetings, when the patient's family starts trusting me, there's a good relationship, gradually I will bring in these topics. The patient is saying that he's pain-free, but then he says that he's becoming weaker and weaker. He's asking me why he's not getting better. What should we do? At that point of time, I am not asking the family, what will you do? I am not asking myself, what will I do? I am asking, what will we do? Because now I am making the family a team member, the one who has to actively participate in decision making. So I'm asking, the patient is saying, my pain is better, but I'm becoming weaker and weaker. Why am I not getting better? So I'm asking the family, away from the patient, what will we do? Because if this continues, after some time, the patient may say, I'm not getting any better, take me to some other place. Then what will we do? So these are the ways, as I said, I can't do a workshop in this, we have very limited time. This is the skill where we slowly get the family to realize that the only option in front of them is to allow the patient to be told the truth. So these topics will come in later, and gradually we turn around the family's orientation towards the importance of communicating bad news. Next slide. And once
you have the family oriented. I always tell them, see, many a times the family says, doctor, I cannot talk about this to him. Can you talk to him? I said, okay, fine. I will talk to him. However, when I talk to him, I will not tell him if he does not want to know. I'll try to find out whether the person wants to know or not. If he wants to know, I will tell them. Otherwise, I will not tell them. So this is how I would approach this. And it is also important to know that this skill is much more difficult than communicating bad news. And it's very important to understand that you should not push your agenda onto the family too much, because otherwise you'll get pushed back. There can be friction in the relationship. So, and if there's friction, there's a very good chance the patient may take the patient away from you. So whatever good you could have done for the patient, then you will have no chance to do it. So it's always it's important to maintain a good relationship. Managing collusion and getting access to the patient to communicate bad news may happen, may not happen. Even if it does not happen, that's fine. There is no shame in trying and failing. There is no shame in trying and failing. The only shame is in not trying. So always try to get over the collusion by winning the trust of the family and have a good relationship. And once that is there, bring about these topics, which I talked about hospital hopping, doctor shopping, et cetera, and then get them into a situation where they say that, you know, either I will say, or doctor, would you help me with this thing? Or there may be families who will continue to resist telling it to the patient despite your best efforts. No problem if you fail, but at least make an effort. I'll stop there. And if you have any questions related to collusion management, I'll be happy to take them. Should we move on to the next topic?
Yes, Tijo. I think we will take the questions.
Okay, right. Next topic is on how to deal with an angry person. Now, I want to emphasize that we are not talking about law and order problem here. We are not talking about how to deal with a mob, which is intent on violence. We are talking about individual cases of anger, which we come across on a regular basis in our clinical environment. And if we deal with it in the initial stage itself, there's a good chance of it not escalating into a serious problem. So essentially, what is anger? Anger is a high energy consuming negative emotion. So what we need to understand it is an emotion. It is a negative emotion, and it takes up a lot of energy to sustain that emotion. So the best thing to do is to cut off the energy supply, and then it will easily come down. Now that is where the skill lies. Remember, anger is a manifestation of emotional stress, just like crying is. So when somebody is crying, we don't feel that negative about that person. But if somebody is getting angry, we also feel very negative about this person. So what we have to understand is anger is not only a negative emotion, it creates negative emotion to others who are subjected to the anger. For example, if a family member is getting angry at you, you will also experience anger inside you. Next slide. So the important thing is to control the anger before it gets out of hand. Now, how to handle this anger is to facilitate anger to flow away. The analogy I can think of is ascitic tapping. When you have a big abdomen full of ascites and there is a lot of discomfort associated with it, hitting the abdomen is not a solution. It does not take care of the problem. So hitting the abdomen is like arguing with somebody who is angry, or trying to give them some justification or excuses. All of that is not going to be a solution. Another option is ignoring the ascites. Do not look at it. Not looking at it will also not solve the problem. Similarly, somebody is getting angry, ignoring that person will also not solve the problem. In fact, confronting an angry person or ignoring an angry person, both can be fuel which can increase the anger. Hence, what we need to do is just like you put in a needle and drain the fluid away so that you're facilitating the fluid to drain out of the abdomen in a controlled manner, we have to drain the anger in a controlled manner. And how to do that is like this. When you see somebody who's very angry, they are usually standing because there is so much of adrenaline in the body. It is very difficult for a very angry person to sit down. So when there is full of adrenaline because of anger, the person will be standing. So it's very important that your body language should match. Your body should match, the body position should match the person. So you also stand up. When somebody is getting angry, do not sit and listen to the person, because that will only increase the person's anger. Because when you sit, you are giving a non-verbal message that I'm superior to you. So it is very important that when you confront somebody who is very angry, you also stand up. If you are a doctor and you're sitting in your chair, you also stand up. If you're a nurse, you're sitting in the nursing station, you stand up. So the both bodies are in standing position is in alignment. Aligned bodies have better chances of communication. The second thing to do is to bend the spine slightly forward in kyphosis. Do not bend it too much, because then it will appear that you're trying to mock the person. Just a slight kyphosis. This shows non-verbally. You make eye contact because you want to tell them that you are not afraid. You are confident. So you have a confident and respectful stance in front of the angry person. So you are neither threatening by the kyphosis, nor are you ignoring because you are making eye contact. So you are not giving the person any chance for more anger. And when the person is saying things angrily, you stand and listen. And when we talk about listening, that means you also shake your head in the affirmative, like you nod your head as the whatever the person is hearing, whatever the person is saying. So stand with spine in a small kyphosis, eye contact, confident look, but not disrespectful. Confidence is to be tempered by respect. And then nod your head and listen. Don't say a word. And with this, the high anger will come down very fast. But the anger will not go away completely. But the high anger, because that is the dangerous part of the anger, the high anger can come down with this method. This is the tapping of the ascitic fluid analogy. And once the high anger comes down, then you can open your mouth and say, "Sir, I need to know more about it. Can we sit and talk?" When the anger comes down, only then you talk to this person and say, "I want to know more about it. Can we sit down and talk?" And then you allow the person to ventilate whatever more emotional distress they are having. So anger, just like crying, is an outcome of emotional distress. It's a high energy consuming negative emotion. So facilitating it is the best way of correcting all the day-to-day clinical anger you are likely to come across in your day-to-day life. Next slide. Remember, it is not just the patient and family that gets angry. You also get angry. So most important part is to take good care of yourself. Do a bit of self-care. Be kind on yourself. Be nice on yourself. This is the only life and body you have. Take good care of it. And how to manage your anger is to, you can have a buddy system. If you have a good friend who is also a colleague, ask them. If you don't have a good friend, at least you choose whatever colleague you have. Tell the person that if I'm showing any early signs of anger in the form of raised voice or too much sarcasm or negative comments, or if the expression on my face is becoming evident that I'm getting angry, then please warn me. Just poke me in the back, or just give me a missed call on my mobile. Do something to let me know that I'm getting angry. Because when we get angry, we don't know. And many a times, without we knowing, we may come across a person who's getting angry. And that is like fire meeting fire. And then we can have a big fire. So it is best to be avoiding, preventing fire. So if you are angry, you are unlikely to know about it. Have a spotter, a colleague, or a friend, or a family member who will give honestly, who will warn you that you are slowly getting angry. And that is the best way to control your own anger. Next slide. I think we'll stop there. And I think we're already overshot our allotted time by 10 minutes. If there are any questions on any of the three topics, I'll be happy to take. Maybe now or after the case presentation. I yield back to Sunil. Thank you, Sunil.
I see there are two questions. One is, who should communicate the bad news? Is it the operating diagnosis physician or the operating surgeon?
I have already talked about it in my presentation. I'll be curious to know how much the other participants have picked from what I've told. Can we take a poll from the participants?
Yeah.
By the video chat. What does the participants think? Who should be the person?
Please give your answer in the chat box.
I said whoever it is must have the trust of the patient, should have information, and should have the skill to communicate bad news. And who is the best person for that? Who has all three?
Yeah. There are a few comments. Anyone, the patient first.
Right. We are getting excellent comments. Yeah. I guess people are paying attention. Thank you for those who have been contributing. It is great to know that you have been listening attentively. Thank you again. I think the answer is very clear.
So what do we do when patients usually come alone and has been diagnosed with cancer? He insists no one can come from his family to the hospital.
Right. I guess it depends on the situation you are facing. If you are from a culture where usually the family accompanies the patient, like in how it is in India, then this would be an unusual situation. However, there are many places where the patient comes to the hospital alone. The bringing of the family would be unusual in that kind of situation. So if you are working in a place where the patient autonomy is held to be sacred, and it's a usual norm for the patient to come alone, and then it is clear that your communication should be directed to the patient itself. However, if you are working in a culture, in an environment where it is the family which brings the patient to the doctor, to the hospital, so then it may be a little unusual. So you can ask this particular patient whether is there anybody that you want to bring along with you? What is the usual way? Is it just once in a while that you come alone? Or is it the usual thing? If there are any decisions to be taken, should I only speak to you, or should I also speak to others in the family, because there's a lot of cultural variations. So we have to be sensitive to the cultural variation. Because in, for example, in India, I can only speak about the Indian culture, we have to be very careful about the fact that the family has a big say in the decisions pertaining to the patient. It is rare for an Indian patient to be taking decisions alone. But I have come across some very well-informed patients who, you know, take decisions on their own. They don't want their family's opinion about it. And in those kind of situations, I had to deal directly with the patient from the very first. I've also had situations where I have to deal with the family and, you know, with the patients later, which is more usual in my case, in my practice. So the person who has asked this question, my answer to that would be, you will have to talk to the patient and figure out whether what is the normal thing for that person, whether it's the collective approach to the healthcare decision making, or it is an individual approach to the healthcare decision making, and then proceed accordingly. There is no absolute yes or no answers to this kind of thing. Remember, I had told earlier, there are some doctors who say, I tell it to every patient. There are some doctors say, who I tell it to none of the patients. But remember, it has to be an individualized model, whether the patient wants to know or the patient does not want to know. That's not applicable only for communicating bad news. I think for all kinds of communication, it will be applicable.
I think we'll move on to patient story, which will be presented by Dr. Evangeline P. Santiago from Philippines. So Dr. Evangeline, it's over to you.
Okay, thank you. Can I share my screen?
Yes, doctor, you can.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, doctors. And as the Filipino greeting, magandang hapon, magandang gabi. I'm going to present this case. I am Dr. Evangeline P. Santiago, a medical specialist, a family medicine in the Philippines. Our case for today is a 65 years old female with a diagnosis of adenosquamous cell carcinoma of the pancreas, stage 4, cholelithiasis, status post laparoscopic cholecystectomy. So the initial presentation of our patient was a right upper quadrant pain, and the condition started 3 months prior to consult at the primary clinic, where the patient started with an on and off vague abdominal pain associated with fatty food intake. She consulted a local private practitioner. Ultrasound of the liver and the hepatobiliary tree was requested, and she was given antispasmodic and a PPI, which afforded relief of symptoms. Because the symptoms abated, she failed to return for follow-up until 1 week prior to consult at the primary care clinic. The pain recurred, now localized at the right upper quadrant, pain score of 8 over 10, now with radiation to the back, characterized by as vague, sometimes piercing, with a feeling of bloatedness. It was associated with heavy meals and not relieved by the medication she was previously given. She has with her the result of the ultrasound requested by her previous doctor with the findings of multiple echogenic foci in the gallbladder, which was consistent with the diagnosis of cholelithiasis. She was given PPI and a prokinetic and was referred to general surgery for further evaluation. Okay, the family medical history, the past medical history were unremarkable, as well as the personal history of the patient and also the occupational history. Review of system showed a weight loss of about 10% for the past 12 months, and the early satiety was noted. So for the physical exam, it was unremarkable, except for the tenderness in the epigastric area during palpation. For the course of illness, she was seen by the general surgery within a week of referral. Elective laparoscopic cholecystectomy was done. However, intraoperatively, there was a finding of mass at the posterior part of the head of the pancreas. Resection was done with a high suspicion of malignancy. MRI was done on the first day post-op. The results showed a suggestive metastasis were seen in the lungs and the peritoneal cavity. Also, lymph nodes were also affected. So the histopath result came 5 days post-op with a well-differentiated adenosquamous carcinoma of the pancreas result. So the diagnosis was adenosquamous carcinoma of the pancreas, stage 4, and she was referred to oncology service. The oncology service plan was the chemotherapy was no longer an option, and the patient is for discharge. Patient was referred for palliative treatment. So the patient was seen by the palliative service. The following were noted. The patient herself was not told of her diagnosis, and the attending doctor, the general surgeon, and the oncologist only informed the patient's husband of the diagnosis and the plans for the patient, which apparently because the husband requested it to hide the diagnosis to the patient. So the main concerns of the palliative service were the following: disclosure of the bad news to the patient, since the husband did not want the patient to be informed of her diagnosis. The older children of the couple wanted to do everything for their mother to get cured, so they still prefer to undergo treatment, to push through with the chemotherapy. The younger children, however, wanted to inform the patient of her diagnosis. And with the family, it was the oldest child who decides for them, and there was an obvious collusion in the family. So I'm going to present the genogram of the family. This is our index patient. She lives with her husband and the family of her children. So these are the carers, the identified carers of the family of the patient, the two younger children. And the two older children are both working abroad. They are the source of who supports the medical expenses of the mother. So what the palliative service did was, initially family meeting was done prior to discharge, initially with the husband and the two younger children. And CA counseling, CA is a form of counseling that we do with the patient or the family. It is a form of catharsis, education, and action form of counseling. During the catharsis, the misperception or the perception of the family were noted. The husband thought that informing the patient of her true condition will make her depressed. And according to the husband, since it was the older son who supports the medical expenses, it was him who has the right to decide for the family or for the patient. And as for the younger children, they thought that the patient should be informed of the diagnosis, since the patient should be prepared for whatever will happen. So the family meeting ended with a family counseling done, and it was agreed upon that another family meeting, this time with the other children, the one working abroad, will have to attend. And the concept of home care palliative plan was discussed to the family members. So the second family meeting was done virtually through video conferencing, since the children were based abroad. And misperceptions or the perceptions of the children, they thought that the patient, once the patient will know of her diagnosis, she will get affected emotionally, and it might even contribute to her faster deterioration. And the older son says that they have to give the all possible treatment, because there is a possibility that the mother will have a chance of getting better, and because they believe in miracles. And for them, giving all to their mother is the way of repaying her for all her sacrifices for them. So the third family meeting happened 2 days after the virtual meeting with the older children. This time it was attended by all the family members. So everyone agreed that the patient should be told of the diagnosis, but they requested that the patient should be informed gently, the gentliest possible way of disclosing the diagnosis. And as the family physician, as the palliative care service provider for the patient, I informed the family on how the disclosure will be done to the patient. So at least they were satisfied or pacified with their fears. So 7 days after the discharge from the hospital, a home visit was done for disclosure of diagnosis to the patient. So it was done using the SPICE protocol with husband in attendance as requested by the patient. And the patient accepted the diagnosis lightly, no too much emotion. And the only concern that she had was how many months does she still have? And if there will be pain as the tumor or as the cancer will progress. So it was addressed accordingly. So for the follow-up, palliative service did a twice a month home visit. Concerns or the advanced care directives, the pain management plan were addressed, and also the wishes of the patient for the rest of her life. So the patient request were a daily visit to the beach, and son-in-law gladly complied, and she wanted to be allowed by her family to do her favorite things to do, like gardening and going to the mall. And she requested to die in the hospital because she doesn't want her grandchild to be scared of her ghost if she will die at home. That's a cultural thing, that a cultural belief that she had. So 4 months after the diagnosis, the patient developed jaundice. The pain she experienced was tolerable at 4/10, so there was no need to give opioids. The pain was relieved with tramadol. And she was asked to be brought to the hospital because she felt that her time was near. And 3 days after, she peacefully passed on in her sleep. So for the discussion points, in the disclosure of bad news, how much bad news should the patient know? I guess was already addressed a while ago. And is it the right thing for the attending physician to withhold the diagnosis to the patient at the request of relative, and how will you address the collusion if it involves not only the family members but the attending physician as well? So that ends my case presentation. Thank you everyone for listening.
Thank you, Dr. Evangeline. That was a detailed presentation and was a very good one indeed.
Thank you.
So the first question was, is it a right thing for attending physician to withhold the diagnosis to the patient at the request of relative? We don't have much time. I think we will, if anybody want to answer any questions, please have your comment. Anybody? So any questions? Yeah, Dr. Ranjita says it's the patient's right to know the diagnosis. In disclosure of bad news, how much bad news should the patient know? We should find out why the relatives want to hide from patients. Yes. So we should find out the concerns of the family members. That's
cool. Okay, add on, we should find out the relatives. Like the culture in the Philippines, I think it's similar with India, that the patient and the family usually tend to be overprotective with the family member, with the patient. Like they don't want to add another burden of worrying about the illness, aside from they don't want to feel emotionally burdened by the diagnosis. I think it's a cultural thing in Asia and including India that we protect those that we love or those that we cared for.
Yeah. So, Biju?
Yeah, I just wanted to echo what Dr. Savitri just mentioned, that Evangeline, that was an excellent presentation, especially the pictures that you put up. They are really, really, you know, they touch the heart. Excellent presentation. Couldn't ask for better presentation for this topic. As far as the questions, yeah, you really did well. I'm sure you're doing a great job in Philippines.
Thank you.
Right. So as far as the questions are concerned, I guess all of them have been attended to, I think. In going back to the thing, the patient has the right to know. The patient also has the right not to know. And it is our job as healthcare providers to find out what the patient wants. So it cannot be a one model that fits patients. It has to be an individualized disclosure model. We have to find out whether the patient wants to know or not. And if the patient wants to know, then we have to figure out how much the patient wants to know. And now we know how to do that. And when it comes to collusion, we have to understand why the patient's family is trying to collude with us. It is out of love. And then we have to make sure that we win their trust and, you know, help them calm down and make them see the benefits of communicating bad news. And that is how we reach the patient with the family on our side, not on the opposite side. So I guess that's it. We couldn't have asked for a better case presentation for this topic than what Dr. Evangeline has done. So thank you for that.
Thank you, sir.
So how will you address the collusion if it involves not only the family members, but the attending physicians as well?
Oh, I guess it is about creating awareness among our colleagues, the importance of communicating bad news, also empowering them with skills on how to communicate bad news. It is only out of ignorance that our colleagues in healthcare, our doctors' colleagues, they say, no, you should not tell it. It is just lack of information and lack of awareness. Because as they say, that communication skills training is not part and parcel of our medical education training. So that's why we have this problem. But that's how we have
yes,
to
go may forward. Yes, may I add? I'm not sure if it's the same with India or with Indonesia, but here in the Philippines, it usually the attending physician, like surgeons or the internists, they have a hard time disclosing diagnosis. They usually refer it to the family medicine specialist to disclose the diagnosis. I'm not sure if it's the same with the other countries. But I think in the United States, usually they don't have a hard time informing the patient of the diagnosis. They usually get the diagnosis from the attending physician himself or herself.
Yeah, Dr. Evangeline, you are right. My experience and a lot of our fellow colleagues in palliative care, I'm sure, have the similar kind of experience that our disease treating colleagues have a difficulty and in this area of communication. I guess the reason could be that in palliative medicine, while we're getting trained, there is a lot of emphasis on communication skills. I think this much of emphasis is usually not found on in other training programs, in other postgraduate training programs, or for that matter, undergraduate training programs. I guess that is the only difference, that they find it difficult to talk about these things. Our advantage comes only because we get trained for it. So it's not that our colleagues are in any way lesser in terms of their ability to communicate. The only disadvantage that they have is that they never got an opportunity for formal communication skills training. But I would like to hear from others also, others who are in palliative care. I would like to hear what Sunil has to say, or other palliative care people, if they are in this group.
Anybody has any opinion about this?
Maybe it should be included in the curriculum during the basic medical education, because disclosure of bad news is not only for cancer patients, but also for chronic illnesses, or for nowadays the pandemic. It also includes acute or those who those illnesses with rapid progression. So I think every doctor who will graduate from medical school should be trained to at least the basic communication skills, like active listening skills and the disclosure of bad news.
Yeah, in India, Medical Council of India has included some of the palliative care topics in the respective years. So ethics, communication, and one more topic. And now pandemic is also included as one of the topic for undergraduate students. So I think maybe over a few years, everybody will be able to handle the problem of communicating bad news and how to manage pollution.
I think there has always been one more issue that till now, most of the time, there was this thought that good communication skills is actually a talent. Some people have it, some people don't have it, which is not true at all. I mean, it is like saying some people have the talent in taking a blood pressure while others don't. It is not true. We have to train people. It is something which can be learned by anybody, irrespective of their personal, whether they are introvert or extrovert, or they have talents in language. None of that matters. It is something that can be learned by anybody. Right, but that happens only if you have a structured training program as part of curriculum. If that is not there, then you know it doesn't work out. So it is very important to have a structured training program. It should be part of the curriculum. Only then everybody will benefit out of it.
Biju, it will take time, but for the time being, so if the treating physician is also colluding with the family, how would the palliative care physician will manage that situation?
I guess we will have to have a session with the treating physician first. It is very important we know that liaising with our colleagues in our surgical specialties and medical specialties as part and parcel of palliative medical care. It is important to, you know, meet them, talk to them, whether in their room or in the corridor somewhere. It's very important to have a continuing dialogue with our colleagues in the treating specialty. And for the physician who is colluding along with the family, I will go and talk to the person and try to change their orientation, just like we are trying to do now on this webinar.
Yeah, so communicating bad news or managing pollution is not a one-day affair. It may take time. You should be able to talk to your friends. Sometimes it may be your friend who may be colluding with the family and hiding the news from the patient, or maybe any other doctors in the hospital. So you will not be able to disclose the diagnosis because of the family as well as the treating physician. So once you maybe you can talk to the treating physician, and maybe over a course of time, maybe after 3 or 4 consultation, the patient and family will trust you and you have built a relationship with the family. And then when you tell something, they will believe you. Otherwise, what happens is this patients always believe the treating physician than the palliative care physician many times when they are in a curative stage. But when they come and have four or five consultations with the palliative care people, then they will start believing in you. Then you may be able to win the trust of the family, and you will be able to break that pollution also. So I think we have to wind up the session. Patient has the right to know the diagnosis, but how much should the patient know? It also depends on the patient. So it is a tailor-made information that we have to give to the patients. And for addressing the pollution, we have to work with the family and also with the physician if possible. And we have to do all the efforts, of course, with the treating physician to make him aware. Disclosing the diagnosis to the patient is very important. And why and the treating physician also thinks that, okay, by breaking the news, that will cause emotional trauma, or the family will tell the physician that, okay, he has attempted suicide previously, and we don't know whether by disclosing that diagnosis he will go and suicide. So all these are problems. So we have to talk to the physician and give the reasons why should we disclose the diagnosis. So we have to make more awareness among our colleagues. So thank you, Biju and Dr. Evangeline, for your wonderful presentations, and thank you all for your active participation.